Hey Charles.
Hey, Pete.
I'm going to go through some modal curve fitting tips today. Have you ever used a stabilization diagram?
Yeah, I've used it plenty of times. Kind of tough sometimes.
Kind of tough sometimes. Well, here I got some modal data, and I'm going to do a curve fit. And it's going to use all my FRF measurements here to calculate a stabilization diagram. And the idea of this stabilization diagram is the modal software, it doesn't really know how many modes are in the structure, but like in this case where it says five, it's going to look for the five best modes to describe the FRF data. And you can see each letter here represents a mode as a certain frequency and damping associated with it. And if it didn't see that on the previous step, it gives it this O, meaning I never saw it. And then as we keep going along, some of the solutions become very repeatable or stable. It gives it this letter S to say it's very repeatable, both in frequency, damping, etc. D is repeatable in damping, F is repeatable in frequency, and things like that. So we're typically looking for this strong column of S's.
Okay.
Yeah. Does it matter which S I pick?
Yeah, if it's become stable, probably not, right?
Yeah, it shouldn't matter. So I would go through and I would pick the modes here. And this one actually is two modes close together. It looks like one peak. And then I can calculate the shapes and I have my modes. Looks pretty straightforward, huh?
Looks pretty straightforward.
Yeah. And by the way, this here is a summation of all the FRFs, but it is using all the individual FRFs to calculate the stabilization diagram. And it's up to us. This is just a visual guide that gets superimposed. I can say selected function here, and I can highlight a bunch of the FRFs and then use that in the stabilization diagram. It'll, you know, just show me. Switch that to DB and maybe move that over. It's just helps guide me as to where and which S's I should pick. Does that kind of make sense? Did you know that you could fool around with how you see this sum?
Yeah, I didn't know that. It does use all the FRFs, but using the sum can make it a little clearer sometimes too for me.
Yeah, or a particular FRF or whatever. But the fact is, there's not always a strong column of S's. I think earlier you said you had some challenges curve fitting sometimes.
Yeah, I do have that problem.
Here, let's look at something that's a little more complicated. So previously I was showing a plate. This structure has a lot of subcomponents like an engine, steering wheel, etc. And let's take a look and see what that looks like. I got my bandwidth selected. I'll calculate my stabilization. And I do have some nice columns of S's for some of these modes. So here I have a column of letters, but there's no peak. So not 100% certain if I should pick these modes.
Yeah, just looking at the sum, it's hard to tell. Would this be an area where we could look at some of the end over FRFs?
Yeah, well, exactly. We got all these subcomponents. So if I go to this modal data selection, you know, I can actually see that, you know, these all have different names and things like body, engine, wheel. So for example, if I came in here and I pick wheel and I hit return, notice this list now just has the wheel. And if I go to the curve fitter, I see just the wheel here. It might be interesting, instead of looking at an overall sum of all the FRFs, to just have a sum of the wheel alone, or a steering wheel to be clear, that I can look at and reference. Maybe I'll do the same thing for the engine. So I'll pick engine here, can go back here, save a summation based just on the engine points. And I'll go back one more time. We'll have all the points back in. And now I'll do my stabilization again. This original sum is all the FRFs, but now I can go in here and I had saved steering wheel sum. So I'll throw that into the display. And then I had done the same thing for the engine. What do you think, Charles?
Well, it looks like it's related to the engine.
Yeah, exactly. I made this a little bit thicker here. We could see a peak in the engine that we don't see in the sum of all the FRFs. And I don't see that in the steering wheel either. So yeah, like you said, it looks like this might be an engine mode. Why is the sum of the steering wheel higher than the rest, Charles? There's fewer steering wheel points. I'll tell you why, because the word sum is a little misleading in our
test. Yeah, I think you have to divide by the number of FRFs or number of degrees of freedom.
Yeah, it's a normalized sum, some fancy term like that, where we divide by the number of FRFs. So the steering wheel FRFs are divided by the number of steering wheel FRFs. The all sum is divided by the number of all of the FRFs. Hence, you can overlay these. Otherwise, the sums of the steering wheel and the engine would be a lot less. So I got a few modes selected here already. Heck, maybe I'll clear them out, just start over again. So, and I'll pick up one there as well. And so this one, we think is probably a engine mode, was right around 13.7 hertz. Let's take a look. So some of these lower modes are like rigid body modes of the whole structure. So these are global modes.
Yeah, everything's moving.
11 hertz looks like a torsion or something like that. 13 hertz, which only showed up with that engine sum. Oh yeah, it's just a mode of the engine. Being able to do that sum on the various components gave us some insight there.
I think your idea of the components was better than my idea of trying to put all the FRFs on there and pick it out.
Yeah, I think it would be a little bit more confusing if we had like a million FRFs here rather than a sum of each of the separate components.
I agree.
Here, let's look at another example. So here I got this structure, which looks something like this. It has two references. So you can see here that I got a reference in the Z direction, a reference in the X direction. So if you look here, the Z direction was vertical, and then the X direction was fore aft along this structure.
So you're excited in those two directions, got it.
So here's another, instead of like doing the point filter with the components, I'm just going to exclude this whole reference as if I only took the data with a vertical exciter reference. Does that sound like fun?
I'm curious to see what it looks like.
Yeah, so I'll go into the curve fitter. I'll hit stabilization, and we got everything here. And we got, yeah, beautiful columns of S's that align with the modes, right? Well, actually, like in here, what do you think, Charles?
Wow. Seems like there should be a column of S's right there.
Yeah, because we have a large peak, but there is no column.
Yeah.
Let's see, if I go back here and I had this excluded, so now I'm going to say included again and recalculate the stabilization. Oh, look what happened, Charles.
Oh, now they're excited.
So now I got a mode here, right around 69.8 hertz or so. It looks like there's two mode in there. Must have been, right, I'll hit shapes, calculate. And yeah, so 34 hertz. Let's keep taking a look here. Yeah, what do you think of this mode, Charles? It looks like it's primarily side to side of this upper cowl, right?
Yeah. Exactly.
It might be hard to excite it in the vertical direction. Maybe that's why it didn't show up so well in the stabilization diagram.
That makes sense. That makes sense.
Yeah. By having our exciter or more than one exciter in different directions, we can excite the modes well in multiple directions at once and be able to do this, find the modes in a better way. Right. So again, in this case, we had a nice column of S's that corresponded to this peak when we had both exciters. If I went in here and I excluded this one, did the same operation, I don't see a column of letters that correspond to that mode, because the FRFs that I excluded from the curve fit contained that mode. So I don't see it. And the sum is from all the FRFs.
Okay, I understand that.
Let's take a look at another example. Here I got a structure like this. I think I might even have a picture. It's like a transmission housing or something like that.
Yep.
And I'll go in and I'll calculate the stabilization diagram. And in this case, you know, what looks like we have some closely spaced modes here.
It looks like that's what it might be.
And here I got like a cluster of modes too, all around this one peak. I don't have like a single column of S's. Any ideas why that might be?
That's pretty big transmission. Did you happen to take your data in patches?
Yeah, if I go back here, yeah, I had to take it in six different patches.
Okay, maybe then so I got some frequency shifting.
I had to move the accelerometers between each one of these six acquisitions. So I guess the mass distribution changed because accelerometers have mass. If I just pick one of these, let's see what happens if I go to the stabilization. That looks a little bit clearer, doesn't it, Charles?
Yeah. I don't see like a double columns of S's there.
Yeah. And if I include all of them again, I can even see that some of these peaks split up because they shifted slightly between each move, and then you get these multi columns. So I guess less than clean data.
Not optimal.
Yeah. And part of the challenge is that if I was to analyze all of this data at once, everything is a bit shifted.
Which S do you choose, Pete?
Yeah, which S do you choose? And in fact, you can even have modes that are less than perfect because this is all the same mode, just shifted. So you're not going to get maybe the correct shape. We do have this thing called multi-run modal. Ever use this, Charles?
Just a couple of times. You're going to have to remind me how it works.
So what I'll do is I'll go in and I'll curve fit each one of these sets of FRFs separately. And I get a partial mode shape for each one.
Okay.
And I've called those from setup 6, setup 5, setup 4, et cetera. I'll pick one of these as a set of target modes, which is add here. And then you pick the other sets to combine the mode shapes together. So what happens is, in this case, this 581 hertz from the target mode, the 579 hertz from setup number 4 is the shape will be combined with that, and we'll call it 581.107 hertz. 577 isn't quite the same as 581. It shifted a little, but I'm still going to call it 581, combine these modes together to get the full mode shape.
Okay.
And all you have to, after doing that, you hit this merge modes and you can do it. If I had curve fit them all at the same time, we call that all runs, versus doing this process where I merge the modes. Mm-hmm. I'll do a MAC here. Let's look at the results here. You see this mode shape here on the left, Charles?
Yes. It's a bit different than the one on the right. It doesn't look real mode. It looks a bit complex.
Yeah. Kind of wiggling a little, if you will, if that's the right word. And a complex way, whereas this one over here, everything is moving perfectly in and out of phase. But this one, not everything is perfectly in and out of phase. And if you're going to correlate this to a simulation model, those are normal modes in the simulation model, right? Which behave like this. That's what we expect the structure to do, perfectly in and out of phase, not this complex shape.
Yeah.
So, not only do we not know which S to pick, we also, if we pick one, we might get the wrong shape. It has a, it looks very similar, but it's complex. So we're not going to get a perfect comparison back to our simulation model, for example. But by doing the multi-run modal, we can get a perfectly in and out on normal mode as we would expect. So yeah, I hope those tips helped, Charles.
They did. I think that'll be very useful.
Cool. Well, we'll talk to you later.
All right. Thanks, Pete.
Yeah. Bye.